compassion over us and the whole house of Israel, and pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Amen.
Sing Shalom, sing Shalom to God.
Thank you. city, but we are looking for that city that is to come. Through Yeshua, therefore, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of our lips that confess his name. And do not neglect to do good and to share with others, for with such sacrifices, God is pleased.
Thank you.
longer on the throne. And you should be on the throne of our hearts. So speak to us, Abba. Speak to our hearts. Reveal yourself to us. to his voice. We open our heart to him in obedience. He is with you. He's never going to leave you. We proclaim, Adonai, you are the king of our hearts. Yeshua, you are the king of my heart. Speak that right now. Yeshua, you are the king of my heart. Let no other reign in my heart. I look to no one else but to Yeshua.
Her husband, who was on a cruise with her while she was not feeling well. So, the comedian last night, we went to a show on the ship, and the comedian looked down, he said, he was a very good comedian, very funny, very clean, and it's amazing how funny things can be when you don't have to be trashy. But he looked down, he said, is anybody new here? And Keith was sitting down toward the front, and he raised his hand. He said, how long have you been married? He said, about a year. He said, where's your wife? He said, she's back in the room. She's pregnant, not feeling well. And he said, dude, you brought your newly pregnant wife on the roof. So what's her name? And he said, Nefertiti. And he said, does that mean she's a Greek goddess? I tapped Keith on the shoulder and I said, dude, you have one right answer to this question. So anyhow, we had a good time, but please pray for Nefertiti. She's having a tough time. Also, Wendy is struggling a little with C interaction. So, she did a lot of prayer this week, though, so that was good. Amen. We're going to go into our liturgy right now, but I did want to thank the young people for their prayers. Look, if you guys have some kind of need, these young folks, they know how to connect with the Lord.
Amen.
Get them to pray for you.
Amen.
It was powerful. Also, please pray again for her and wife and family.
You'll hear that
blessing
anymore, do you?
Huh?
You hear that blessing anymore?
And with joy shall draw her water from the fountains of salvation.
Who shall combine this and so be my head next to her?
Thank you. are who? Bless the Lord, the blessed one.
Bless the Lord, the blessed one, for all eternity.
Baruch Hu Adonai the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall not do any work.
For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Blessed be the Lord, blessed the Sabbath day in our lives.
Speak also unto the children of Israel, saying, above all my Sabbaths you shall keep. For it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that you may know that I am the Lord, who sanctifies. The children of Israel shall keep the Shabbat, observing it throughout the generations as an everlasting covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Shabbat to another, all flesh shall come to worship before me, says the Lord.
Thank you.
none like our Lord. There is none like our King. There is none like our Deliverer. Who is like our God? Who is like our Lord? Who is like our King? Who is like our Deliverer? Let us give thanks to our God. Let us give thanks to our Lord. Let us give thanks to our King. Let us give thanks to our Deliverer. Blessed be our God. Blessed be our Lord. Blessed be our King. Blessed be our Deliverer. You are our God. You are our Lord. You are our King. You are our Deliverer. You are he to whom our fathers offered before you the fragrant incense.
Amen.
Thank you.
I looked at it, it was fun though. I know this is out of order and all that, but it was fun to watch the grandparents with the kids. Because grandparents with kids have an entirely different expression on their face than parents with kids. Grandparents are like, oh no, I have to give it up now. And parents are going, oh yay, I get to give it up. So it's an entirely different experience when you're a grandparent. I love my grandkids. Anyhow, on page 65 of your Siddurah is the blessing before reading from the Torah. Baruch Hu Adonai HaMevorach.
Baruch Adonai HaMevorach Le'olam Va'ed.
Baruch Adonai HaMevorach Le'olam Va'ed. Baruch Adonai Eloheinu Melech Ha'olam. Asher Bachar Banu Mikol Ha'amim. V'natan Lanu Et Torato.
Baruch Adonai.
Adonai spoke to Moses, saying, tell Bnei Israel to take up an offering for me from anyone whose heart compels him. You are to take my offering. These are the contributions which you are to receive from them: gold, silver, bronze, blue, purple, scarlet cloth, fine linen, goat's hair, ram skins dyed red, seal skin, acacia wood, oil for light, spices for the anointing oil, and for sweet incense, onyx stones and setting stones for the ephod and the breastplate. Have them make a sanctuary for me so that I may dwell among them. You are to make all precisely according to everything that I show you, the pattern of the tabernacle, the pattern of the furniture, and all the furnishings within, just so you must make it. Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Asher Natan Lanu Torat Emet V'Chaye Olam Nekafet Epinu.
Baruch Ata Adonai Noten HaTorah. Amen.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us the Torah of truth and has planted eternal life in our midst. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah.
Bezot HaTorah Asher Samoshe Lifnei Bnei Yisrael Abiyah Adonai Beyad Moshe.
And this is the Torah that Moses placed before the children of Israel at the command of the Lord from Moses' hand. Amen.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who selected good prophets, was pleased with their words which were spoken truthfully. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, who chooses your Torah, your servant Moses, your people Israel, and prophets of truth and righteousness. Then the king commanded, they quarried great stones, costly stones to lay the foundation of the house with cut stones. So Solomon's builders and Hiram's builders, along with Gebalites, cut them and prepared the timber and the stones to build the house. Now it came to pass, 480 years after the children of Israel came out of the land of Egypt, in the fourth year of Solomon's reign over Israel, in the month Ziv, which is the second month, he began to build Adonai's house. Now the house that King Solomon built for Adonai was 60 cubits long, 20 cubits wide, and 30 cubits high. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, Rock of all eternities, faithful in all generations, a trustworthy God who says and does, who speaks and makes it come to pass, all of whose words are true and righteous. Faithful are you, O Lord our God, faithful are your words, for not one of yours is turned back unfulfilled. For you are faithful and compassionate, God and King. Blessed are you, O Lord, the God who is faithful in all his words.
Amen. James, I'll be reading from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, beginning at verse 1, for our Brit Fetishah reading. The blessings are on page 71.
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher natan lanu mashiach yeshua, v'hanivrut shel ha-brit ha-kadoshah. Baruch atah Adonai, noten ha-brit ha-kadoshah. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us Messiah Yeshua and the words of the new covenant. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the new covenant. Amen. Now about this service to the Kedoshim, it is indeed unnecessary for me to write to you, for I know your eagerness. I boast about it to the Macedonians, that Achaia has been preparing for a year already, and your zeal has stirred up most of them. But I am sending the brothers in order that our boasting about you may not be in vain in this case, so that you may be prepared, just as I kept saying. Otherwise, if any Macedonians were to come and find you unprepared, we, not to mention you, would be put to shame in this undertaking. So I thought it necessary to urge the brothers to go on to you and arrange ahead of time your generous gift that had been promised beforehand, so that it would be ready as a gift and not as an extortion. The point is this: whoever sows sparingly shall also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully shall also reap bountifully. Let each one give as he has decided in his heart, not grudgingly but under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. God is able to make all grace overflow to you, so that by always having enough of everything, you may overflow in every good work. As it is written, he scattered widely, he gave to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. Now the one who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in everything for all generosity, which through us brings about thanksgiving to God. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher natan lanu hadavar ha-emet, v'chayei olam netah betokeinu, Baruch atah Adonai, noten ha-brit ha-kadoshah. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us the word of truth and has planted life everlasting in our midst. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the new covenant.
Please rise as we return the Torah to the ark.
Shabbat Sermon.
children's book. I want Miss Jane to do the audio version. Doesn't she have the sweetest voice? She really does. She just so sweet. I don't know how she ever yells at Tom. Okay, good morning.
Good morning.
We are on Parsha Terumah, and because my iPad is at my house, wasn't on the cruise with me, I'm going old school. I'm actually using a book with pages.
Amen. So,
and some of you young people, they made books at one time, with pages, words. You had to actually turn the paper to, okay. Anyhow. Once again, I'm so grateful to our young people. If you're one of the ones that was at the Bay meeting this last Saturday, thank you so much. Unbelievable, but believable. Isn't that cool? Anyhow, we're on Parsha Terumah. It's my favorite Parsha. I look forward to this Parsha every year. Just can't wait to dig into it, to share some of the things that Adonai has put in his word. Terumah begins with the verses we read earlier, which deal with the taking up of the offering to make the tabernacle or the Mishkan in the wilderness. Terumah actually is a word that means offering or giving, to give. And so they're taking this offering to build this really nice tent. And what I love about this is that, you know, we build buildings and we do things, and I'm not against buildings, we have two. So I'm not against them. But I think that sometimes in our thought pattern, we think we have to build something nice for God to dwell in, which is really true, but it's not the building that he wants to dwell in, it's the people in the building that he wants to dwell in. And sometimes we spend more time worrying about the building than we do the temple that he really wants to dwell in. When David gets all concerned, he wants to build a house for the Lord actually kind of laughs at him in his response. He says, "The heaven is my throne, the earth is my footstool. How are you going to build a building big enough to house me?" And so while the tabernacle is an amazing structure, it was not God's instruction to Israel to build him temples like they built among the pagans. Matter of fact, while we were in Mexico this week, we went on a museum trip, and they had scale models of Aztec temples, pyramids, huge buildings and edifices that were built to do everything that God teaches us not to do, including human sacrifice. And there were these amazing construction projects, huge projects, and when God instructed his people to make a place for him, he said, just make a tent. You know, you can have nice decorations and stuff, but make a tent and make it the way I tell you to make it. And so that's the essence of the beginning of what we're dealing with here, is he talks about giving an offering. And I always, when I come to this parsha every year, you almost feel compelled to have to talk about giving and tithes and offering and giving from a willing heart and all that, but I really don't want to talk about that this morning. I do want to say thank you to all the people who do faithfully give. Those of you that aren't faithfully give, let me just say you're missing out on God's blessings.
Amen.
And I encourage you, just faithfully give and tithe and in offerings. And those that are watching online, I forget to say this every week, but if you feel led to contribute to the ministry, you can go to our website and contribute to any of it. If you want to give to the prison ministry or the homeless ministry or the youth ministry or any of the different things we do, you're welcome to do that. Not only welcome, but encouraged to do that. If you have a home congregation, the online people, give to your home congregation, and then if God moves on you to give offerings here, do that, but make sure you're giving faithfully to where you attend. phone call this, not phone call, text message. I always say phone call. Just assume when I say phone call, I'm talking about text messages, because almost nobody phone calls anymore. But I just can't process. It's kind of like I still talk about albums, even though CDs don't hardly exist anymore. So I'm like three mediums old now. So anyhow, I got a text message from somebody who says, I don't live in your area. There's no synagogue near me. Can I tithe to your congregation? Because I watch your videos, services on video. And it's one of those questions you want to say, yeah, tithe, offer, tell your friends, your family, your relatives, everybody. Put up signs in your town. But at the same time, you always feel like somewhat self-serving. It's like somebody says, is it okay if I buy you dinner? It's like, sure, I want you to buy me dinner, but that's because I want to eat. And then you get wrestling between the, do I want them to be blessed or do I want us to be blessed? And there's really a balance between those things. So anyway, but that's not what I want to get into, although I encourage you to read about this and really look at the words about giving from your heart. I want to talk about this week's Parsha, because this week's Parsha begins the segment in the scripture about the Mishkan or the tabernacle in the wilderness. It is the largest section of commandments that we read in the Torah. It's not the most commandments in a parsha, but it gives us all the instructions, all the way down to minutia items in here. And somebody asked this morning, why is it, I think it was Rivka, why is it that we have all this information about building a tent, and we have so little information about things like Yeshua's young life? I mean, Yeshua is born, he has his Brit Milah, and then he goes away from his parents. Then we don't hear about him again for nearly 30 years, or 20 years at that point. So there's not a lot of information. There's lots of things in the Bible that give us just a few words, a few verses that cover immense things, like some of the greatest, largest wars we read about in Exodus are a few sentences. The crossing of the Red Sea is only a few verses. This seems to be one of the most significant events in the Bible, and it's just a small amount of information, and we're left to fill in a lot of blank spaces with our minds. Matter of fact, that's why we get such lousy movies about those things, is because there's so much creative license necessary just to make it seem like something, because we know the water went back, but we don't know what that looked like. I saw comic the other day. I started to get him to put it up on the screen. It reminded me of Fred, our elder Fred. I love Fred. Fred's got one of the biggest hearts, and just he's just a neat guy. Plus, he's my hero. He married a woman who's like 40 years younger than him. And if you can do that, you just get bonus points for that. There's just no, and he married a good woman. So anyhow, but I saw this comic, and it had the Israelites crossing the Red Sea, and there was a guy with a fishing pole fishing into the water on the wall. I said, that would be Fred. There's no doubt Fred would be walking through there, and he just thought, oh, this. I went on a cruise with Fred, one of the congregation cruises, and said, where's the area where I can fish from? Off the cruise ship. I thought that was me. So anyhow, it made me think of it. But we don't know what that looked like. We don't know what the water looked like, when it was, how high it was. We just know it, the wind blew and it stopped. It could have stayed the same level it was. God's really cool. He doesn't have to make it pile up to do it. It says it kind of made a wall on both sides, but we don't know how high that was, and we don't know how deep it was to begin with. So we just have to fill in the blanks. But this information that we get to on the tabernacle, it goes from chapter 25, then we have chapter 26, 27, 28, 29, 30. It is an extensive list of how to make all the items in the tabernacle. And I believe the reason for that is that the tabernacle is a symbolic telling of every aspect of biblical information. You can find the answer for every question you have within the tabernacle. Now, you may not yet believe that, but hopefully by the end of this hour and a half message, you'll kind of join with me. So the tabernacle is made up, And the Lord says to make it, and we start all of this stuff in it, and we deal with things like, he says, make the curtains with cherubim, make on the Ark of the Ark of the Covenant, there's cherubim on it, there's images on different things, and somebody asked a question this morning and said, you know, it says we're not supposed to have images, don't make any graven images, but it doesn't actually say that. In chapter 20, when you read the second commandment, which is the commandment of idolatry, it says, don't make any graven images that you bow down to worship them. It's not making images that's the problem, it's worshiping those images that's the problem. But that's not where that verse stops. The verse goes on to say that there will be curses on those who disobey God, but there will be blessings to how many generations? 1,000 generations to those who keep his commandments. So the second commandment in the list on 20 that we call the Ten Commandments is actually a commandment that says not keeping God's mitzvot, his commandments, is idolatry. And so as we're walking through these things and we're seeing them, we've noticed that the tabernacle has three sections. Israel had three sections. There were the Israelites, the Levites, and the Kohanim. It was made that way purposely to show that the tabernacle is symbolic of Israel. It's also symbolic of us. And people say the body, the soul, and the spirit, that's not where I was going. But you can use that if you want to. I don't know how you symbolically make it that way, but it might work. You can work on it. I'm going with, we have the outer court, and then we have our, believe it or not, the Bible says our stomach, not our heart, or it's actually liver and organs, but it actually is the part that we digest things with. And then our mind is actually what the scripture refers to as our heart, in context. So we're broken up into the outer, and then the part that digests and serves us, and then the part that should serve God. The same way in the tabernacle, the outer court was where people serve people. The inner court is where people serve God, and the Holy of Holies is where people fellowship with God. There's different stages in everything, and when we walk in our life, each of those things have a part of service to God, but part of our life as believers is serving other believers, because when we serve other believers, it's serving God. And there's other parts where we serve God in a way of receiving from him, the table of showbread, the altar of incense, which represents prayer and praise, the menorah, it's receiving and interacting with God, but the third part is when we fellowship with God. And Catherine's teaching the other day on Tuesday night was that whole progression in her teaching, although she may not have put it in that context, but she was talking about prayer. And prayer, real prayer, is not just, I'm going to pray for Ivan because he needs help. That's useful. It's prayer. But there's something beyond that where we get into the spiritual. It's not just, Ivan says, Rabbi, I'm sick. Can you pray for me? I go, okay, Lord, do something for Ivan. You know, and we just respond with a human-to-human prayer. It doesn't mean God doesn't respond to that. But it's not the thing that God's talking about when he talks about prayer. Then the next stage is where we say, Lord, Ivan needs help. And all of us know that. Ivan needs help. Enlighten me with the menorah. Let me digest what it is you want me to share, and then let me pray for him as I worship you. And then the last part is when we can actually commune with God in that prayer. It's when we enter into that supernatural realm. Every aspect of the tabernacle speaks to different aspects of our life as believers, and it's important for us to understand that. The tabernacle gives us the plan of salvation. There's the outer, the entrance to the tabernacle. I've shown on the video before, some of you have seen this, but the entrance, when you were just looking at the tabernacle, you couldn't see an entrance because it was an offset curtain.
curtain. So you had two curtains that stopped and then an offset curtain. So looking directly at the tabernacle, you couldn't see how to get in. You had to draw near. And once you drew near, you could find your way in. And the scripture says in order to come to God, we have to draw near to Him. That's how we find the entrance into serving God. We draw near to Him. And then when we walked around the curtain, we came to the first thing there, which is the altar of sacrifice. The altar of sacrifice is symbolic of repentance. It's about making ourselves a living sacrifice. It's about giving ourselves to the Lord. And that's the first step. Once we come to see we have a need of the Lord, and that, you know, for many of us, I know with me, I thought I was perfectly fine until I found out I needed the Lord. It's kind of like when I needed glasses. I went to the eye doctor, I thought I saw perfectly. I went to the eye doctor and he said, you need glasses. And I got glasses. I saw things I had not known were there. I preached at a church one time, and in the back where the exit sign is here, there was a clock there, and I thought it always thought just had no hands. I mean, it had hands, but no numbers. And I was preaching there after I got glasses. I went, there's numbers on that clock. Everybody thought I was nuts. Why would you stop a message to say there's numbers on it? It was a revelation to me. But there's many of us, you know, when before I came to faith, I didn't know I was lost. I didn't know I needed something. But the Lord called me, and I drew near to Him. And when I drew near to Him, I saw what I needed, and it was to enter into Him. And so I entered in, and then when I entered in, I realized that I needed to give myself to God. It isn't enough just to come near. You know, we have some people that come to our congregation still today that are not yet born again. They come faithfully to our congregation and watch on video and different things like that. They yet have not made the decision to go past knowing there is a God to giving themselves to Him. And unfortunately, there are some people who think they're serving God because they realize He's God and they're not. And sometimes they pray, and sometimes they even give to Him, and do that, but they haven't given themselves to Him. And so the first thing you come to is this altar of sacrifice. And then after the altar of sacrifice is the brazen laver, the place of washing. And we know as believers that when we come to Him, we need to get immersed and have our sins washed away. That's what the scripture says, arise and be immersed, washing away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord. So we come and we repent and then we're washed. And then after that comes that first curtain into the holy place. And after we've repented and after we've been washed, He fills us with His Spirit. And we enter into that place where we can receive. Because the scripture says the carnal mind cannot receive from God. You have to have His Spirit in order to receive from Him. And so that's where the table of showbread, representing the Bible, the Word of God, the bread of life, the menorah, which represents the light of God shining on that Word, and then the altar of incense. And it's interesting, the altar of incense is a unique piece of furniture that they even make wrong at the places like Shiloh in Israel where the tabernacle sits in their diorama things. Because the Bible says that the ark had four rings, that the poles went through, that the table of showbread had four rings that the poles went through, but the altar of incense only had two rings. And even there, I got into a discussion with the tour guide. I said, that's wrong. And he said, no, it's not. I said, yes, it is. It's what the scripture says. There's only supposed to be two rings on the corners. The reason for that is that it's a symbolic thing that deals with our prayer and our praise. And the neat thing, if you have four rings in something, there's ring here, ring here, ring here, ring here, pole going that way. When you have men carrying that pole and it goes up a hill, what happens to what you're carrying? It goes off balance. Doesn't matter whether you go up, down, it's off balance. But you have two rings on it, you go uphill, it stays balanced. And in our lives, as we serve the Lord, our prayer and our praise. That's what I'm talking about. You have the section where you pray and the section where you praise. The section where you ask the Lord and seek the Lord, the part where you just worship Him. That keeps us balanced. So when we're going uphill, we're balanced. When we're going downhill, we're balanced. It's a beautiful symbol, and it's part of this tabernacle that God is making for us. The outside of the tabernacle was made out of curtains made from either seals or manatees or badgers or other whatever kind of animals it is. We really don't know. And depending on what Bible version you have, it does. But we know it's not a pretty outside. The inside was beautiful, but the outside was just plain. Peter says, let not the outward adorning be fancy, but let the inward of the heart be what's beautiful. Everything about the tabernacle teaches us something about, or answers questions about, how we interact with God, how we interact with each other, and how we should live. Every phase of the tabernacle is that way. The priests are that way. The Levites are that way. The songs that are sung are that way. Every part of it shares something meaningful to us about the Lord, our relationship with Him, our relationship with others, our relationship as a group with Him. And it's so important we understand that, because the reason God asked them to give to that was He wanted the value of that to be participated in by everyone. It's a group thing. The rich people of Israel could have paid for all of it. But the Lord said, I want everybody who has a giving heart, a willing heart to give, to do so. It's an amazing thing. Every color in it has symbolism. There's red, which represents the blood. There's purple, represents priesthood and royalty. There's gold, everything. The wood, humanity, wrapped in gold, God's purity. Everything about it. The nail going in and out of the ground, because it was only put halfway, the tent peg, specifically, you're to put halfway in the ground. Not all the way in. Everything is described in intricate detail, because God has painted this amazing picture. And I think of it two ways. One way I shared in the early class, that God paints, the Bible is a paint by number. And the tabernacle is the main feature in it. Why? Because the tabernacle not only begins with sacrifice, offering, blood, all of those things which talks about the Messiah. It talks about Israel, how we relate to the Messiah. Every step, it has a plan of salvation. The dimensions have spiritual significance. Every number used tells a story and a meaning. It's encapsulated, but it's like paint by numbers, where anybody ever do paint? Do the people still do paint by numbers? It's blue is 2, so you color in all the number 2s. You get the next one. So all you see is blotches on the paper until it starts to fill in, and then you get to see what God actually had as the full picture. I watched a friend of mine, her name is Joelle Macon. She's an amazing artist, and she painted a wall that was almost as big as that. And she's a portrait artist, but she did backgrounds for a church, and she walked in with a can of brown paint and a 4-inch paintbrush. And she walked up to the wall and just down the wall, just splashed paint on the wall. And I sat there for hours watching her as she changed colors and just slapped paint on the wall. The end result was this amazing Jerusalem scene that she saw in her head. But I had no clue until it started to fill in the colors and the pictures. Listen, I encourage all of you to go back and read the tabernacle. Start looking at the numbers and how they relate. Start looking at the colors. Look at the pictures. Look at the diagram. Look at the order it's made in. Look at the involvement of the priests and the high priest. Look at the involvement of the people involved. Look at the people who gave it. Look at the fact that much of the stuff that was done was given by non-Jews to the Jews to build the tabernacle. There's a revelation that God is fulfilling as non-Jews are sharing the things of God with Jewish people as they come to see Messiah in the Tanakh prophecies that they were blinded to. Years ago, I went to a friend's house and they had this picture on the wall and it just looked like a big blotch of color. And they said, if you look at it right, you'll see the space shuttle. Anybody see, you guys remember those things where you had to look at it for so long and all of a sudden they would come into?
Yeah.
I had to lie to them. I just wasn't going to stand there long enough to see it. Oh, that's cool! I didn't say I saw the space shuttle. I said, man, that's cool! And it's kind of like, that's some baby. You can't tell something, but you have to, But the Bible. I didn't realize there was a baby there. I didn't realize it. That one's adorable. Those are adorable too. But in the hospital, look, I don't care who you are. You look down at the baby, you're lying. The parents are going, this is the most beautiful thing in the world. The rest of us, that's an alien. Especially if it's natural born. Anyhow, I digress. Just saying, it's the truth. It becomes beautiful as the head kind of rounds back out and stop being a Saturday Night Live character. But I know, I was going to explain that to you later. So, anyhow, the tabernacle. Too many people don't find Messiah because they skip the center of the picture. They just never see it. And because they don't see it, they can't understand what he did, why he did it, how he did it, how symbolic it was, how powerful it was, what the design was, because Hashem is the greatest designer in the world. And not one word is out of order, because each piece of the tabernacle fits perfectly, beautifully, to share how God wants to take care of us. He made a tabernacle in the wilderness so that we would have a place to meet him and comfort. It's weird because God's everywhere. But the human mind can't process everywhere. We have to have a focal point. We have to have somewhere we can look at and think of and say, I'm going to synagogue. Why? I'm going to go worship God and meet God there. It's like, well, why don't you do that here? Isn't he here? Isn't he at work? Isn't he at the grocery store, the gas station? Is he ever? Yes, he is. But for us to be able to focus, God knew we had to have a place. But he wanted that place to be more than just a place. He wanted that place to be instructional on every level, in every direction you looked at it, no matter whether you're above it, below it. Matter of fact, if you looked at the tabernacle from the top and you could take the cover off of it looking down, you have the altar of sacrifice, the brazen laver, the altar of incense, the menorah, and the table of showbread. Right in the center of the tabernacle is a cross.
Amen.
But if you don't read it, those pieces are not painted in your picture. You can't see it. And it's so beautiful that the altar of for the brazen laver, made from the mirrors of the women of Israel. Why made out of mirrors? So that when you walked up to it to be washed, you could see who you were. You know, we need to see who we were so we can become who He wants us to be. And when our sins are washed away, we come up and we see we're sinners. We see we need cleansing. We see we need that. The table of showbread had to be changed out every week because we have to have fresh manna, fresh bread every week, fresh from the Lord every week. It's not enough to go on what you had 20 years ago or 10 years ago or 5 years ago. It has to be renewed every week. The menorah had to be lit every night. Why do you light it at night? Because it's dark. When did Yeshua come? In the darkness, He was our great light. It's all part of who and what we are. But if Yeshua believers, if people that don't believe, that believe in Yeshua don't understand even just glimpses of these things, even just parts of the pictures, we miss out on what we have available to share who Yeshua is, who God is, how He works, how His Ruach interacts with us, how we enter into His presence. Every part of these chapters that we're reading, that too often we look at and go, they built things. They gave money, they built things. They built lots of things. They took it down, they put it up. They made posts, they made curtains. Whoop, whoop, whoop. And that's many people read that, the whole section. It's like the only thing we read less than the tabernacle instructions is the genealogies, which are meaningful also. We just go, and they had kids. When something important happened. This is the largest section in the Bible, in the Torah. It's got the most instructions of any part of the Torah. And yet it's part of it that we read the least. We know it's boring. There's nothing boring about the tabernacle.
Amen.
If you understand its purpose is to give us instruction on everything else. The tabernacle is in the center of Israel to remind us that God has to be the center of our lives. The tabernacle is a place of sacrifice, and you brought your offering there. You had to make your way there. You had to walk in between. And I know I'm almost out of time. I dislike modern altar calls. I just don't. First of all, we shouldn't have to call people to the altar. I mean, I understand it's the way our society is, but what's supposed to happen is God's supposed to convict people's hearts so much that they come to the altar. You know, I've been places where people say if you see a sinner next to you, grab their hand and walk them up front. If somebody tried to do that to me, they wouldn't be walking anywhere. Go to church, they say, bow your head and close your eyes. Now, if you want to accept the Lord, just quietly raise your hand so nobody notices. Is that not contrary to God's plan? When we repent, when we come to faith, it should be the most exciting thing in our lives and the lives of everybody around us. there should be humility and exaltation in the same moment. The only thing I've ever seen anywhere close to that is a woman having a baby, where she's in intense pain and yet overwhelmed with joy at the same time. That's what's supposed to happen when someone's birthed into the kingdom. I don't know anybody who goes, anybody who's going to have a baby this year, just quietly raise your hand so nobody notices. Keep your eyes closed. We don't want anybody to realize they're sinners in here. I pray to God for sinners to come to synagogue every week. I want more sinners than believers in synagogue. It's just the way it's supposed to be. The whole purpose of the tabernacle was, and remember the tabernacle, God spent all this time on it. It's the most important thing in the Torah. Was purposely designed for sinners. There is more information in the Tanakh on what sinners should do. And yet we spend all our time dealing with what believers should do. And we look at it that way because we think once we become believers, we've left the sinner category. Let me tell you right now, I know you. I ain't convinced. You know me. You ain't convinced. The central theme of the Bible is the tabernacle. Why? Because everything in it is about the Messiah. Everything in it is about the Messiah. Wood, humanity, symbol of humanity in the Bible. Gold, symbol of God. Flesh, God. You know, it's just amazing how this works. And yet we leave it off to the side as an unimportant thing. Sometimes we talk about the offerings, and that's important. But the important part is not the offering, it's the message of the offering. The important part is the message of the colors. Why purple? Why gold? Why silver? Why goat skin? And the rope had to be made from goat hair. The tent rope. Did you ever try to weave goat hair? Did you ever smell goat? Okay. There's things in there that we need to pay attention to. God was intentional. Sheep stink. Sheep are dumb. Not all of you. It's so important that we look at these things because every sentence is a message from God about the Messiah, about himself, and about us, and about how we relate to each other. It's not just a list like a shopping list or a architectural guideline for building a building. It's God's plan for you individually. Every one of us sees the tabernacle from a different view, and every one of us has a correct view of the tabernacle. Because each of us see God differently. That's why we don't have an image of him. And if you see God from a pure heart, you see an accurate portrait, even if it's completely different than mine. Because I see him through my experience and where he spoke to me, and you see it through your experience and where he spoke to you. Everybody looked at the tabernacle and saw a different thing, depending on what angle you came from. If you were on the tribes on this side, you had a different view of the tabernacle. But your view of the tabernacle was no less valuable than anybody else's view of it. Just like your view of Messiah was no less valuable than anybody else's just because you viewed it from a different place. Some of us in this room were drug addicts. Some were immoral. I can't tell you the number of people that have come up to me and said,
Rabbi, I was pregnant before I got married. In our time, I know none of you see the people that didn't come today. Or I was an alcoholic. People were criminals, people were in jail. Please don't Google the people in our congregation. It's just a bad idea. We all come from different places. One of my thrills as a rabbi is watching you guys bloom and grow. I have the privilege of performing a wedding in the maternity room. Minutes before. Yeah. I do! Pammy, was I right?
Yep.
She was there. The witnesses were the nurses. And I said, Rabbi, would you do this? Yes. Yes, I'll be glad to marry. I want that baby born into a family that's joined together, that's connected by God, where God's joined together with no man. I want that to happen. To me, that's a positive thing. We don't have to, it's so amazing to me that God's plan for the foundation of the world was to provide a means for us to be delivered from sin. And the center thing of the Torah is God's meaning for us to be delivered from sin. And the central theme of the New Testament is that God intended for us to be delivered from sin. And yet most of us struggle with being delivered from sin. There's a difference between understanding forgiveness and deliverance. I used to steal cookies from the cookie jar. Do you guys have cookie jars anymore? I would say, my mom would catch me and I'd say, oh, I'm so sorry. And there was, I was sorry, mostly for being caught, but I was sorry. There was sincere sorriness in there. But that didn't change the fact that the next time she had cookies in there, there was a good possibility I was going to pilfer the cookie jar. It's because I sought forgiveness, and I received it. My mom was a very forgiving person. She did move the cookie jar after a while, but she was very forgiving. But I didn't change. And that's the wrestling match that most of us have. Because we're bound by things like drugs, even if we're not taking them. We're bound by them if we're not delivered. Pornography, jealousy, anger, rage. One of the young people came up to me Saturday, and I know I'm going long, but I think this is important. One of the young people, we broke up into groups, and one of the young people came and said, Rabbi, I've just been having a terrible time with anger, and wanted prayer that he could be delivered from anger. There's no reason for it. He says, I know it's spiritual because I get angry over the dumbest things. It's not like there's a reason to be angry, just everything, just, you know, the wind blows the wrong way, I'm angry. He's being attacked by the enemy, and he came and he said, Rabbi, would you help me? He didn't just say, Rabbi, would you help me feel better? He said, Rabbi, would you pray with me that this goes away, that I'm delivered from this? Most of us spend a lot of time repenting for things we should be delivered from. I was an alcoholic. Most of you know that already. I'm not an alcoholic. I'm not one of those people, you know, hi, I'm Eric, I'm an alcoholic, I'm going to be alcoholic. I know. If I wanted to, I could drink a beer. I hate beer, but I could drink one. I wouldn't go get drunk. Because God delivered me from it. He delivered me to cigarettes. I smoked cigarettes when I was 8 till I was 18. Not 19. 19, I got married. A different kind of father. And I married someone who was smoking.
You know, sometimes I have to say something nice and hits up for the other ones. I would throw in my cigarettes time after time after time and then go buy new ones. When I came to faith and asked the Lord to deliver me, they were gone. Instantly. That's the way we should be with every sin in our life. It's not, you know, we talk about repentance and we should repent, but we need to get delivered. The tabernacle, when they brought a sacrifice to the tabernacle, they didn't put it on the altar and then it burned for the rest of their lives. It was consumed. It was gone. It's something we need to understand. And one of the reasons we don't understand what true forgiveness and deliverance is, because we don't study what happened at the tabernacle. We don't see the broad picture. And so we walk around dragging our sins with us, wondering why we can't overcome them. That's not how God wants us to live. And he wrote chapter after chapter of intricate detail so that we wouldn't. And unfortunately, too many of us have never read it, studied it, and made it part of our lives. Let's all stand. Okay. Before we say the Aaronic benediction, let me say this, because I just found out that somebody busted a water line across the road and we have no water. So you're welcome to fellowship as much as you want to, but we're not going to be able to clean anything up. So we thank you for your own egg food. I'm sure you'll enjoy it at home. Or if you know somebody in the congregation that could use some meals for this week, let them have it and let them take it home and enjoy it. But we're not going to be able to have bathrooms and we're not going to be able to have kitchen and all until they get it fixed. Okay? But you're welcome to stay and hang out as long as you want to.
Thank you.
announcements. There's bread in the fellowship hall. Please take it home with you. If you don't need it, you have neighbors that do, people that you can give it to. Number two, don't forget whatever you're going to do with the tzedakah box, if you would go ahead and take care of that. There's fancy class at 1 o'clock. And don't forget your children. Yeah, there's desserts and stuff back there, so please...